I'm standing here across the wadi from some of the most famous archaeological sites in the world, Tabun Cave and Skhūl Cave. These places represent the transition, initially in Tabun, full transition from lower Paleolithic, from an Acheulo-Yabrudian industry, all the way up into the middle Paleolithic, a Mousterian. It includes human remains, a Neandertal skeleton, another jaw that might be Neandertal, might be modern, and Skhūl Cave nearby includes some of the earliest modern human skeletons found anywhere outside of Africa, but modern humans with a number of archaic human characteristics. This little area has produced some of the most famous and some of the oldest archaeological evidence in terms of the history of archaeology, and has really helped to frame what became the debate about modern human origins. What accounts for the succession of different skeletal morphologies in this region, and what accounts for the fact that the archaeological industries of this time are showing that whatever the people looked like, they were making the same sorts of tools? Well, this is a very famous area in Mount Carmel, but in fact, it's a tiny part of Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel is a very famous part of northern Israel. It's a limestone massif that's been elevated by geological processes, and that limestone is karstic. It's rich in karstic activity. That means that water percolating through the top of it is making openings down inside the rock. It's making caves. As we'll see, those caves evolve over time. They become open at different times, they accumulate sediments at different times, and eventually they begin to collapse and begin to erode. So that complex association of different events geologically leads to a complex association of events archaeologically. Here on Mount Carmel, we have evidence spanning from more than 200,000 years ago right up to the last few tens of thousands of years. But no single cave preserves the entire record. The closest is Tabun Cave, right across the wadi. Tabun has lower Paleolithic industries overlain by a series of middle Paleolithic industries. It is the place that gives us something of a chronology that we can apply to other sites in the region. I've come up here to Skhūl Cave. Skhūl is in the slopes of Mount Carmel. It's a little bit up a wadi from the coast, and it's very near to Tabun Cave. Skhūl is a place where Dorothy Garrett and her workers during the early 1930s found a series of burials of a group of people that they considered to be anatomically intermediate between humans and Neanderthals. The initial interpretation of that sample is based on the fact that when you look at the skeletal remains, you see these features that are clearly like the features of modern humans living around the world today. You also see features that are much more archaic looking. These people now are considered by many anthropologists to be among the earliest modern humans to have been found anywhere outside of Africa. They clearly exhibit a mixture of morphologies that are found in Neanderthals and other kinds of people. This may be a population that was undergoing population mixture here in the Middle East during the initial movements of early modern humans. This sample of humans is so interesting and so important that it's really neat to be able to see this site and see what's going on here. The site still has archaeological layers that are brecciated. They're strongly cemented together. It's not a high priority target for excavation right now, but in the future we may have more discoveries from this site. The Skhūl hominids were redated during the late 1980s, and we now know that they lived here around about 100,000 years ago, maybe a little earlier, maybe slightly later. That time period, the time period during which early modern humans are first appearing outside of Africa, the time period during which we know that they were mixing with Neanderthals, that time period is so interesting that the archaeology of this region has become a real focus of attention. One of the really puzzling things about the skeletal remains in this area is whether we find early modern humans, as we find here at Skhūl, or we find individuals with more Neanderthal-like morphology, as we find up the wadi here at Tabun. Whichever individuals we find them making a Mousterian toolkit, which is essentially the same. This is a case where cultural artifacts are not different, even though the anatomy of the fossils is different. Now, from my point of view, that may represent the fact that this is, in fact, a mixed population. That what they're learning and the cultures that are going on here have relatively little to do with their biological heritages. They're doing what works in this area, using fundamentally similar toolkits, because that's what they've learned to do. But their anatomies are reflecting the different migrations and movements of people through this central area of the world, the crossroads between Africa, Asia, and even Europe. Let's take a look around the site. This is one of the coolest things I've ever seen at an archaeological site. You've still got these grooves in the rock that represent the places where excavators, during Garrett's excavation, were digging in underneath the skeletons to remove those skeletons on pillars so that they could be carefully extracted from the rock in the laboratory. It's a case of the archaeology of archaeology. Skhūl is also a great example of how caves, as we understand them, are actually very complex systems. Here at Skhūl, there is still a cave. There's a cavern that goes deep into the rock here. But that cave is not where very much archaeology was found. The active parts of the cave are still eroding out. The archaeology was found outside of the current entrance of the cave, where there are deposits that were put down here by human activity, by natural activity, during a long time period when this was covered originally by a ceiling of rock. Over time, caves erode back into the rock face. And here on Mount Carmel, this is limestone. It's very tough stone, but it has these natural cavities in it. And as they're eroding away, the ceiling will collapse. And so when we look around the outside of the cave, we actually see huge rocks that have over time tumbled from the ceiling of the cave. We see deposit that was formerly on the floor of the cave and is now outside of the sheltered area, and erosion still continues. So we have what was once a cave that's becoming again part of nature, and nature invading it and eroding it out. Most caves that were open originally to humans are part of a similar process. And archaeologists happen upon them. They may find former cave deposits that are outside the opening of the cave. They may find deposits that were left by hominids acting outside of the cave. When you think about the way that caves are formed and how complex it is, you start to realize just how lucky it is when we find any substantial archaeological deposits, because people are using these sites in many different ways, and much of the stuff that they do is not left behind. You can see really clearly up here how these sites are right on the current Levantine coastal plain. Now, during the time that Neanderthals lived here, the coastal plain would have lowered and risen the sea level against it. And so right now you can see the Mediterranean right out there with the sunset going down into it. That would have been a lot farther away. Today it's 2 or 3 kilometers from here. In the past it would have been maybe 10 kilometers more. So these aren't directly coastal Neanderthals during all the time, but it's certainly a rich area for foraging right out there. And the caves represent the first place that you come up against topography. So it's a very advantageous place for people to hang out. One of the coolest things about these sites is how accessible they are. There are hiking trails up around here so you can understand the geology. The All Israel hiking trail goes right by here, and the caves are now a World Heritage Site. And so with a little bit of interpretation at the site and some tours, it's a place you can really visit. When I say I'm taking you to Skhūl, I mean I'm taking you to Skhūl.